Okay, hi, am I audible to everybody? Am I audible? I hope I'm audible to everybody. Okay, so let's start today's session. Okay, we'll pick up from where we had left and we'll be continuing. Okay, so I'm just going to skip the questions that we had already done last time and we'll start from the next question. Okay, let's start. Fine. Fine. So let's start. Okay, so your question goes as follows. A patient presents, no, we have one more question for this, right? One more question for this, fine. Infection by which of the following viruses cannot be prevented by using SD plasma infusion? Now, what's SD plasma infusion? SD plasma infusion is solvent detergent plasma infusion. Okay, so that's plasma that contains detergent in it. Okay, so which of the following infections will still happen despite SD plasma infusion? Your options are Hep A, Hep B, Hep C and Hep B. Can I have an answer to this? Okay. So I haven't got any answers to this. So the answer to this is hepatitis A, okay? Because hepatitis A is a virus which, out of all the hepatitis viruses, it is the only virus that is non-enveloped, okay? It's the only virus that's non-enveloped. Hepatitis B, C, D, all these are bearing an envelope, right? But A and E, these are non-enveloped viruses, because of which, if you infuse plasma that contains solvent detergent, you're going to destroy the envelope. But A does not have an envelope, so it cannot get destroyed, right? So that's why hepatitis A, also hepatitis E, these two viruses cannot be prevented by using plasma infusion containing solvent detergent. Okay, so move on to the next question. This is important. Viral markers in hepatitis B infection are really important. So a patient presents with the following profile: HBs Ag positive, HBe Ag positive, anti-HBc IgM positive, anti-HBs negative and anti-HBe negative. Which of the following is true about this patient? Is he a case of acute hepatitis B with high infectivity, acute hepatitis B with low infectivity, chronic hepatitis B or post-hepatitis B vaccination? Any answers to this one? Okay, so the answer is acute hepatitis B infection with high infectivity, because as you can see, HBs Ag positive, it indicates that any case with HBs Ag positivity indicates that infection is present. Okay, acute or chronic, we do not know. But HBs Ag present means infection is present. Okay, HBe Ag present, what does this indicate? E indicates replication. Okay, so E indicates active replication. So whenever HBe Ag is present, it indicates that the virus is actively replicating. So active replication means more number of copies. So obviously, it's going to lead to high infectivity. Okay, high infectivity because of HBe Ag positivity, and you can also see that anti-HBe is negative, right? So the antigen is present, there is no neutralizing antibody, so it is in a state of high replication and therefore high infectivity. Anti-HBs is negative, okay? Anti-HBc IgM is positive. M indicates acute infection, right? So what do you have? You have high infectivity, acute infection. So the option A is correct. Acute Hep B infection with high infectivity. Why is it not low infectivity? Because HBeAg is present in high quantities, okay? It is positive, indicating active replication. Chronic Hep B infection, this would have been HBs Ag would have been present, but you would have had anti-HBc IgG type, and you would also probably have anti-HBc, okay? Because of these reasons, it is not chronic Hep B infection, and also not post-Hep B vaccination, because in post-Hep B vaccination, the only thing that you have is anti-HBs, okay? Clear about this? We'll move on to the next question. So this is a comparative table of all the hepatitis viruses. The important things that you have to know here are that envelope is absent in A and in E. Okay. Hepatitis B is the only hepatitis virus with DNA in its genome. We have to remember the families. A is picornavirus. B is hepaDNA. C is flavi. D, it's a delta agent. It doesn't have a family per se. And C is calcivirus. You can remember this by using the mnemonic. Private hospitals favor rich clients, okay? So that's private hospitals favor rich clients, okay? And this is A, B, C, D. Here R stands for the RNA, okay? And clients, okay? This is E, okay? Also, what is important to remember that type A has a vaccine, okay? Type B has a vaccine. Type C, we do not have a vaccine against it yet, because type C, hepatitis C virus, shows antigenic variation, okay? This is the reason why we do not have a vaccine against hepatitis C virus. This is the same reason why we do not have a vaccine against Neisseria, okay? Neisseria gonorrhea, to be specific. For the same reason, we do not have a vaccine against it yet, okay? Fine. So we move on to the next one. Hepatitis A virus is the most common cause of sporadic hepatitis in kids. Kids is important, okay? Because the most common cause of sporadic hepatitis in adults is hepatitis E virus, okay? Great. It causes infectious hepatitis, fecal-oral transmission, incubation period 15 to 45 days. The virus is detectable in feces within 2 weeks of jaundice. So before 2 weeks to after 2 weeks of jaundice, this is an important time period. You can detect the virus in the stool of the patient who is suffering from hepatitis A infection. Also, no carrier state and no chronicity. Carrier and chronicity are important only for types B and C. Okay. Moving on to the next one. HBV DNA, HBV, this is important. It has two linear DNA strands. Okay, so it has two linear strands of DNA. DNA polymerase is also of two types. So two kinds of DNA strands and two kinds of DNA polymerase. One is a DNA dependent DNA polymerase and one is an RNA dependent reverse transcriptase. Okay, so this virus contains reverse transcriptase as well. It exists in two forms. You might be asked about hepatitis B antigen. HBsAg, remember, it does not have nucleic acid in it. Okay, it's non-infectious. It does not have nucleic acid. It forms HBsAg. So HBsAg, remember, it's just a proof of infection. Okay, it's not infective. It's just a proof of infection. Whereas the 42 nanometer DNA particles are actually infectious. These contain nucleic acid. Okay, they contain nucleic acid. The various genes are important. The most important one is X. X gene inactivates P53. P53, as we know, is a tumor suppressor gene. So if it gets integrated with the host genome, it leads to HCC. This is the reason why chronic hepatitis B virus infection can lead to HCC. Okay, especially if the X gene is present, because it inactivates P53. It will get more time to integrate with the host genome if it's a chronic infection. This is why chronic hepatitis B can lead to HCC. Okay, I hope I'm clear. Okay, move on to the next part. Markers in HBV infection. This is extremely important. You cannot afford to miss this. The first marker is HBsAg. Okay, so remember, S se shuru hota hai. Okay, So HBsAg is always the first marker. HBC is never detected in serum. This is also important because if you're ever given a question about markers in serum in hepatitis B infection and one of the options is HBsAg, it might trick you. Do not choose that option ever. Okay, it's never detected in serum. Whereas its antibody, the corresponding antibody is the first antibody to appear. IgM, if the antibody is of type IgM, that would make it the best marker. Okay. HBeAg, we discussed that it's a qualitative marker of replication. So if there is a lot of HBeAg, okay, you cannot really say that the virus is replicating a lot. Okay. Why is that? That is because there is something known as a pre-core mutation. Okay. If there is something known as a pre-core mutation, in that case, HBeAg titers will be low despite high replication. Okay. So because of this pre-core mutation, we cannot say that HBeAg titers will correspond to the replication. Okay. So what is the quantitative marker of replication? It's HBV DNA. So obviously, the more copies of DNA you have, that is direct proof of ongoing replication. Okay. More copies of DNA will indicate lots of ongoing replication. Okay. And anti-HBs, which discussed, it's the only antibody in vaccinated individuals. So if you ever asked which is the protective antibody, it is anti-HBs. It is protective. That is the reason it is present in the vaccine, right? Okay. And the last question, which is also important, is the only marker in the window period is IgM anti-HBC. Okay. So, yeah, you can remember this anti-Cs through the window. Okay. So this is like anti-Cs through the window. And to remember M, you can remember anti-Mary or something. Okay. She sees through the window. So that's how you can remember that anti-HBC IgM type is most important as it is the only marker in the window period in HBV infection. Okay. We will move on to the next one. HCV is the most common cause of transfusion-related hepatitis in developed countries because blood is definitely thoroughly screened for hepatitis B infection, but it is not screened that frequently for hepatitis C infection, which is why it tends to infect blood recipients. Okay, as we discussed, it shows antigenic variation, so vaccine is not possible. It is associated with autoimmunity, important, which results in mixed cryoglobulinemia. Okay, globulin means antibody, okay, and cryo, which means they are of the cold type, and mixed indicates that there are various types. Okay, emia means in blood, so it is vasculitis. Vasculitis indicates there will also be rash, and this rash is associated with purpura. There is arthralgia because the immune complexes deposit in joints with joint pain, and there is also MPG, and this is very important as a question. They might ask you what is the lesion in the kidney that is associated with hepatitis C infection, that is MPGN. Okay, and it has the maximum risk of chronicity. This is an important question to remember. The maximum incidence, okay, the maximum incidence of chronicity is with hepatitis B, okay, whereas the maximum risk of chronicity is with hepatitis C. Because HBV infections are much more common in, they are much more in incidence. So obviously incidence of chronicity is correspondingly high. Whereas HCV, the number of infections is less, that is the incidence is less, but the risk is much more. Okay, the risk is close to 80%. So if a person develops hepatitis B infection, that person is definitely prone to becoming a carrier and having a chronic infection. But that person has a much higher risk of becoming a case with chronicity if that person develops hepatitis C infection. Okay, we'll move on to the next one. If you have any doubts, please feel free to ask. Okay, we'll move on to the next one. Hepatitis E virus, we discussed, is the most common cause of sporadic hepatitis in adults. It is also known as NANB or non-A, non-B epidemic or enteric virus. no carrier state of chronicity. Again, we discussed this is only important in B and C. These figures are important. 1 to 2% fulminant disease, that is fulminant hepatitis in normal population, but 10 to 20% in pregnancy. So the risk is 10 times more in pregnancy. This since we are anticipating questions where you might get options like A, B, C, D, and then we asked a combination of these in the options like A, B, C are correct or B, D, A are correct, something like that. This is an important figure to remember, that the percentage is 10 times more in pregnancy. Okay, the percentage or the incidence of fulminant hepatitis is 10 times more in pregnancy. Okay, so next one. Which of the following viruses can be cultivated on human fibroblast cell line? This is a direct question. Polio, molluscum contagiosum, measles and adenovirus. I would like to have an answer to this if possible. Any answers? Polio, molluscum contagiosum, measles, adenovirus. Which is the one option that you can definitely rule out, even if you're not aware of the answer? One option that you can definitely rule out. The option that you can definitely rule out is molluscum contagiosum, because molluscum contagiosum and human papilloma virus, these two viruses are non-cultivable. Okay. So obviously if they are non-cultivable, this does not apply, right? So your options are reduced to polio, measles and adenovirus. Now out of these, the virus that can be cultivated on human fibroblast cell line very specifically is adenovirus. Okay, adenovirus can be cultivated specifically on human fibroblast cell line, not on any other cell line. So let's have a look at something related to adenovirus. Okay. The cytopathic effect. What is the cytopathic effect of adenovirus? Any idea? Okay, it's focal degeneration. Okay. Fine. Okay. This is a very important table. You have to remember which serotype. Adenovirus has a total of 47 serotypes. Okay, so you have to remember which serotype is associated with which disease. There is absolutely no easy way to remember this, so you have to give it some time. 3, 7 and 14 are associated with pharyngoconjunctival fever, 8, 19 and 37 with epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, 11 and 21 with hemorrhagic cystitis, 40, 41 with diarrhea, 3, 4 and 7 with acute respiratory disease. The most important ones out of these are epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, okay, also pharyngoconjunctival fever. Fine, we move on to the parvovirus. The parvovirus, where is the receptor of the parvovirus present? Any idea where the receptor of the parvovirus is present? Firstly, the parvovirus, as we probably remember, it's the smallest pathogenic virus, right? It's the smallest pathogenic virus, and it is also containing a single strand of DNA. Okay, what is the receptor? Where is the receptor for parvovirus present? The receptor for parvovirus present is on P antigen on erythroblasts. Okay, that's the important bit. P antigen on erythroblasts, not erythrocytes. Okay, it's not present on mature RBCs. It's present in the baby RBCs. Okay, so if it's present on the immature RBCs or the erythroblasts, do you think RBC production is going to get hampered? Obviously, RBC production is definitely going to get hampered, because when the virus attaches to its receptor, it's going to destroy the erythroblasts. So if it's going to destroy the erythroblasts, it's going to result in hemolysis, right? It's going to result in hemolysis. And RBC counts are going to drop, because baby RBCs nahi hai, toh mature RBCs kahan se banenge, right? So in infants, it leads to what is popularly known as fifth disease. I'm sure everybody knows this by now. With the typical slap cheek appearance, right? The typical slap cheek appearance. And in adults, it leads to type 3, hypersensitivity, also known as Glavan-Stocking syndrome. Okay, in high RBC turnover states like sickle cell anemia, thalassemia, so what is happening here? There's a state of constant hemolysis already. Already RBCs are being destroyed. On top of that, when the virus attaches to the erythroblasts, more RBCs are getting destroyed. So the RBC count is dropping drastically. Okay, this leads to a transient aplastic crisis. Why is it transient? Why is it a transient aplastic crisis? Because there is no problem in erythropoiesis, right? Erythropoiesis is absolutely fine, but RBCs are being destroyed too fast, right? They are being destroyed very fast, but erythropoiesis is fine. So after some time, the erythropoiesis can compensate for the drop in RBC count, okay? So there's a transient aplastic crisis, okay? In immunocompromised states, it leads to pure red cell aplasia. Okay, which means RBCs, they are the only lines which are affected because the receptor again is on the erythroblast. And pure red cell aplasia. Aplasia means not being produced at all. Okay, so aplasia totally not present. And in transplacental infection, it leads to non-immune hydrox. Okay, non-immune because it's a viral infection. It's not immune mediated. For example, hydrox fetalis, which is because of Rh negative mother and Rh positive fetus, that is a case of immune hydrox fetalis. But this is non-immune hydrox because there's no immunity involved, it's just a viral infection. Okay, fine. We move on to the next one. This is the typical slap cheek appearance. What is important to note here is the circumoral sparing. So you can see that this area of the child, it doesn't have any rash. Okay, it doesn't have any of these erythematous markings. Also on the body, you can notice the lacy reticular rash on the body of the child, okay? Also, it is important to note that it'll always be a child given in the picture, okay? So, a child with slap cheek appearance, circumoral sparing and a similar lacy reticular rash on the body definitely points to Fifth disease or erythema infectiosum, okay? Erythema infectiosum. Show some. Okay, great. Pox virus, molluscum contagiosum, we discussed that it's non-cultivable. So if you're ever given a question about cultivation of molluscum contagiosum, that's a trick question. Please do not mark it ever. Okay, in adults, it is sexually transmitted and leads to pearly umbilicated lesions on the genitals, whereas in children, it's transmitted by direct contact. You have similar lesions on the face. Intracytoplasmic inclusion bodies, these are your typical Henderson-Patterson bodies, right? These are your typical Henderson-Patterson bodies. It's an important spotter also. Even from derma point of view, it's an important spotter. So these are Henderson-Patterson bodies and they are intracytoplasmic, okay? So even though HPV is a DNA virus, okay? The inclusion bodies are intracytoplasmic. Okay, that's important to remember. And these are your typical molluscum lesions. I'm sure you must have seen them plenty of times by now. Pearly with a depression in the center or an umbilication. Okay, fine. So, the next virus is human papilloma virus. Again, non-cultivable. Okay, so there is no use of PCR or culture in diagnosis. The viral proteins are early proteins and late proteins. The early proteins are mostly involved in inactivation of tumor suppressor genes like E6 inactivates P53, E7 inactivates retinoblastoma. Okay, so you can remember this, that 6 and 53, there's 3 here, so 6 is like double of 3. So E6 is for P53 and E7 therefore is for retinoblastoma. The two most important tumor suppressor genes are suppressed by HPV infection. And L1, which is a late protein, these are all capsid proteins. Remember, the capsid is the proteinaceous material which is present around the nucleic acid, right? So here you have the nucleic acid and this is the capsid, okay? So this is a component of the vaccine, okay? The vaccine which is given to both boys and girls between 9 to 26 years of age, okay? It's a component of vaccine and this was a question in the last NICT, okay? Now, the most common sexually transmitted disease worldwide is Condyloma acuminata. Okay, these genital warts are the commonest sexually transmitted disease worldwide. Common warts are produced by 1, 2, 3, 4, types 1, 2, 3, 4. This is an important question. A female has genital warts, that is, she has condyloma acuminata. Now she conceives and the child is born by normal vaginal delivery. What will the child suffer from? What will the child suffer from? Any idea? What will the child suffer from? Any answers? Okay, the child is going to suffer from laryngeal papillomatosis. Okay, so papilla produced by HPV virus in the larynx. Okay, and the treatment for this, the drug of choice for this, remember, is sidofovir. Okay, it's the drug of choice for this is sidofovir. So laryngeal papillomatosis, and this is usually recurrent also. Okay, so despite treatment, the child has recurrent infections, and the drug of choice is sidofovir. But if you're asked the management of choice, it is not to go for a normal delivery at all. It is to choose to go for an LSCS. Okay, so this is one of the indications when you're actually going to choose to do a cesarean section if the mother has genital warts, because you know that the child is at risk of developing laryngeal papillomatosis, okay, because of passage through the infected birth tract. Fine. Polyomaviruses, again, DNA viruses. The John Cunningham virus, what is important is that it is reactivated in immunosuppressed patients. So if there's a patient who has JC virus infection but is not, like, the patient has adequate immunity, then the patient might not develop PMLE. Okay, but if the patient is immunosuppressed, then the virus reactivates. Okay, it reactivates, crosses the blood-brain barrier and infects astrocytes and oligodendrocytes and leads to progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. So progressive, which indicates that the disease is going to have a progressive course. Okay, multifocal, which means it's going to affect multiple areas of the brain. Leukoencephalopathy, right? Leuko, which means it's going to affect the white matter of the brain. Okay, leukoencephalopathy. And you know that white matter is what forms the myelin sheath, right? So it's going to be a subacute, a subacute demyelinating disorder. Okay, a subacute demyelinating disorder. Remember, it's a lesion of reactivation in immunosuppressed patients, much like zoster. Okay, much like shingles, much like herpes. It's a disease of reactivation. Okay, BK virus. This is very important. It is very commonly found in patients who receive transplants. In case of renal transplants, it causes interstitial nephritis. Okay, so agar kidney transplant hua hai, it's going to cause interstitial nephritis. But if it's a case of bone marrow transplant, it's going to cause hemorrhagic cystitis. Okay, so it's going to affect the urinary bladder. Please remember this. If the patient has received a kidney transplant, it's going to cause interstitial nephritis. If the patient has received a bone marrow transplant, it causes hemorrhagic cystitis in that patient. Okay, and you can see these casts. These are the typical decoy cell casts which are seen in case of infection with BK polyomavirus. Okay, this might be a spotter for you. Like, they might give you a question that says that a person has received a renal transplant and then after some time his urine is taken for examination and routine examination reveals these. Okay, so what virus or what disease might he be suffering from? So the answer to that is BK polyomavirus. These are very, very typical. Decoy cell casts are very characteristic of polyoma BK virus infection. Okay, next one. Okay, so we have a question here. Which of the following are used by negative strand RNA viruses? The options are DNA-dependent DNA polymerase, DNA-dependent RNA polymerase, RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, RNA-dependent DNA polymerase. Okay, I would like to have an answer to this if possible. Okay, so the answer to this is RNA dependent RNA polymerase. Okay, so So since it's an RNA virus, okay, you're definitely going to have an RNA dependent enzyme, okay? So these two options are therefore automatically ruled out, and you're going to have an RNA polymerase, not a DNA polymerase. So it's an RNA dependent RNA polymerase, okay? So let's see something related to RNA viruses. All of them have single-stranded RNA except reovirus. Okay, so all the viruses that come under RNA viruses have single-stranded RNA except reovirus. Positive sense and negative sense RNA, this is an important question. Positive sense RNA, they can perform direct translation. Okay, so directly RNA से ऐसा प्रोटीन बन सकता है, ठीक है? RNA से डायरेक्टली प्रोटीन बन सकता है. बट इफ दिस वायरस हैज नेगेटिव सेंस RNA, इट मींस दैट इट यूजेस RNA डिपेंडेंट RNA पॉलीमरेज. मतलब जो नेगेटिव सेंस RNA है इसके पास, इट्स गोइंग टू यूज RNA पॉलीमरेज डिपेंडेंट ऑन दिस RNA टू फर्स्ट प्रोड्यूस अ पॉजिटिव सेंस RNA, एंड देन इट इज गोइंग टू यूज दिस पॉजिटिव सेंस RNA टू प्रोड्यूस प्रोटीन. ओके, सो द न्यूमोनिक दैट यू कैन यूज टू रिमेंबर ऑल नेगेटिव सेंस RNA वायरसेस आर ऑलवेज रिंग पॉलीमरेज और फेल रिएक्शन. दिस इज हिमांशु सर हैज ऑल्सो डिस्कस्ड अबाउट दिस न्यूमोनिक. एंड द वायरसेस आर अरीना वायरस, गुनिया वायरस, पैरामिक्सो, ऑर्थोमिक्सो, फाइलो एंड रैपो. ओके, ऑल दीज आर नेगेटिव सेंस RNA, अरीना, गुनिया, पैरामिक्सो, ऑर्थोमिक्सो, फाइलो एंड रैपो वायरस. ओके, so we'll go on to the next question. A 3 months old boy has persistent cough and severe wheezing for 3 days. On examination, his temperature is 39.2 with bilateral bronchi. Chest X-ray shows bilateral interstitial infiltrates. Examination of respiratory secretions and cell culture revealed a characteristic finding which helped to diagnose the causative agent as a virus. Which virus is responsible in this case? Okay. Your options are corona, RSV, measles, and adeno. So whenever you're faced with such a huge question, and you're likely to face such questions this time in NEET, so first just go for the last sentence. Okay. So you've been asked which virus. Now go through the options quickly. Corona, RSV, measles, adeno. Okay. So now you have a rough idea ki you have to try and recall the clinical features related to these viruses only, right? So now let's go back and have a look at the important information provided in the question. First is 3 months old boy. Okay, persistent cough, severe wheezing. Okay, temperature is 39.2, which means temperature is high, so he has fever. Bilateral bronchi. Okay, bilateral interstitial infiltrates. So it is the interstitial infiltrates which are responsible for the bronchi. Examination of respiratory secretions and cell culture revealed this. So there's an arrow here, okay, and you can see that it's pointing to these large pink aggregations. There's a large one here and a large one here, okay. So now you have to think which of these viruses can actually cause this. Now you know that coronavirus will probably not present with bilateral bronchi and wheeze, okay. Measles virus, you would have some mention of parotitis or orchitis, okay. It won't have just cough and fever and wheezing. Adenovirus, yes, possible. We had discussed that types 3, 4, and 7 can cause respiratory infection, but look at the microscopic picture. Here you can see individual cells, right? This is an individual cell, this is an individual cell, these are all individual cells. But here the cells have fused together to form one large pink aggregation, so you can see that there is syncytium formation. Okay, syncytium formation. So this will help you to arrive to the conclusion that it's a case of RSV infection. And RSV, remember, it characteristically affects young children. There is wheezing, very important. There is fever. There is interstitial infiltrates. Okay, presence of interstitial infiltrates. So it does not affect the alveoli directly. There are interstitial infiltrates, and the presence of the syncytium will help you to arrive at the conclusion that it is a case of RSV infection. Okay, so let's see some points about RSV. RSV is a kind of paramyxovirus. Okay, so myxo, the word myxo means mucin. Okay, remember myxedema? Okay, we've heard about myxedema. मिक्सोइडिमा इसमें क्या होता है, म्यूसिन्स, ओके म्यूसिन्स एलिवेटेड, राइट. सो देर आर थ्री काइंड ऑफ पेप्लोमास, एच फॉर हेमोग्लूटिनिन विच इज ऑफ 16 टाइप्स, एन फॉर न्यूरोमिनिडेज विच इज ऑफ 9 टाइप्स, एफ ऑफ फ्यूजन प्रोटीन, रिमेंबर दीज आर एबसेंट इन ऑर्थोमिक्सो वायरस, ओके, एंड ऑल्सो एच एंड एन, दीज आर द वंस दैट शो एंटीजेनिक वेरिएशन. एफ डज नॉट शो एंटीजेनिक वेरिएशन, ओके, एफ डज नॉट शो एनी एंटीजेनिक वेरिएशन, फाइन. सो एच इज द वन दैट एक्चुअली अटैचेस टू द न्यूरोमिनिक एसिड रिसेप्टर. एन is also known as the eluting enzyme or the receptor destroying enzyme. So this is responsible for, once the cell has been infected by the virus, okay, the virus is inside, it uses neuraminidase to lyse this cell, okay, and break out to infect other cells, okay. So it's also known as the eluting enzyme or the receptor destroying enzyme. So neuraminidase, ase means it's breaking, okay. So H attaches to what? Attaches to the neuraminic acid receptor, okay. N, it destroys this receptor to lyse the cell, break out, and it uses it to infect other cells, okay. So, paramyxovirus, the important paramyxoviruses are measles, mumps, RSV. Measles, as you know, fever appears on day 10. Complex spots appear on day 12, followed by a typical maculopapular rash on day 14. Complex spots, you can see, complex spots are bluish-white spots on an erythematous base, first appearing opposite the second molar, the lower second molar, okay? So if you're ever given a question which has this clinical picture and you can see that close to the molar there are some white spots on the buccal mucosa and the question mentions that it's a child who has fever and rash, please go for measles, okay? The order is fever, then complex spots, and then rash. The rash appears behind the ear, then spreads to the entire body, and it disappears in the same sequence. Now measles produces these giant cells, right? What's the name of these cells? In cells ka kya naam hai? What is the name of these giant cells? These are known as Wharton-Finkeldy cells, right? They are known as Wharton-Finkeldy cells, right? Great, they are known as Wharton-Finkeldy cells. Okay. Now the so it produces these giant cells. Because we had seen that they have like myxoviruses, paramyxoviruses, not just RSV, any kind of paramyxovirus. The cytopathic effect of any paramyxovirus is to produce a syncytium. Okay? Fine. So, myxovirus, it tends to mix up the cells. Okay? Yeah. Now, what is the most severe but the rarest complication? And what is the most severe among the common complications? What are the answers to these? Any answers? The most severe but also the rarest complication and the most severe among common complications. Any answers? No? Okay. So the most severe among the common complications is pneumonia. Okay. Pneumonia is the commonest complication, which is the most severe one. Whereas out of all the complications, the rarest one, but if it happens, it's super severe, that's subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. So subacute sclerosing panencephalitis, so it's an inflammation of the entire brain and it is of the sclerosing type. So it is extremely, extremely severe if it happens, but it's also really rare, thankfully, okay? Moving on to the next virus. RSV is the commonest cause of bronchiolitis and pneumonia in infants. Remember, it's in infants. So, if the question mentions a young child, okay, RSV could be one of your options and it leads to wheeze, bilateral wheeze, okay. So, young child, bilateral wheeze, okay, you are going to think of RSV infection. Okay, it has only the F protein, and remember that this F protein, it is targeted by, what is the treatment of choice? It is treated by, yes, it's targeted by palivizumab, okay, which is why you can use palivizumab in RSV infection. Okay, so RSV is associated with wheeze, whereas para influenza is associated with stridor. So look at your question carefully. If it mentions wheeze in a young child, go for RSV. If it mentions stridor with or without barking cough, they might not give barking cough because by now everyone has read it so many times ki barking cough dene se kisi ko bhi croup yaad aa jayega. Okay, so stridor, remember to read these key points easily. Stridor is associated with para influenza virus. Okay, para influenza virus. Fine. And you have to remember the typical steeple signs seen in para influenza virus. Okay, infection in croup. Okay, seen on an AP, right? Yeah. Next one, we move on to picornaviruses. Picornaviruses, remember poliovirus, enterovirus, rhinovirus, calicivirus, and hepatitis A virus. So they can be remembered by the mnemonic POTCH: poliovirus, echovirus, and enterovirus. Okay, rhinovirus, calicivirus, and hepatitis A. So they can be remembered by the mnemonic POTCH. Now, out of the enteroviruses, the most important ones that you have to remember is 72 is hepatitis A. 70 causes AHC or Apollo conjunctivitis. Why is it called Apollo conjunctivitis? Because remember the spaceship Apollo? There was a spaceship called Apollo, right? Us spaceship mein, the astronauts who went on that space mission, all of them actually suffered from acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis because of enterovirus 70 infection. Okay, which is why naam hi pad gaya, Apollo conjunctivitis. Okay, 71 causes hand, foot, and mouth disease, and echovirus causes aseptic meningitis. Not that important, but okay, fine. We'll move on to the next one. So this is a question. Okay, the question goes like this: an 8-year-old child presents with pain and difficulty in chewing and swallowing. Examination reveals multiple vesicles and small ulcers on the palate and posterior pharyngeal wall. Which virus could be the causative organism? Your options are Entero, Mixo, Flavi, and Rhino. Okay, so again, going back to the important points, it's an 8-year-old child presenting with pain, difficulty in chewing and swallowing. So obviously nasopharynx, oropharynx mein kuch problem hai. There are multiple vesicles and ulcers on the palate and posterior pharyngeal wall. Which virus are we thinking about? Your options are Entero, Mixo, Flavi, and Rhinovirus. Any answers to this? Any answers? Entero, Mixo, Flavi, Rhino. No. Okay, so the answer to this is enterovirus. Okay, which enterovirus? Let's see. This with the ulcers and vesicles on the palate and posterior pharyngeal wall, this is a classic case of herpes angina. Okay, so let's see what this is. Herpes angina, remember, is caused by the Coxsackie virus, okay, which is basically a kind of enterovirus. Okay, it's a kind of enterovirus, which is why it is responsible for causing herpes angina, also known as vesicula, so vesicles, pharyngitis, so inflammation in the pharynx. Okay, just like enterovirus 71, it can also cause hand, foot, and mouth disease, acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis. Coxsackie B, this is very important. Remember, Coxsackie B is responsible for causing pleurodynia, also known as Bornholm's disease or devil's grip or epidemic myalgia, with severe acute pain. It feels like a tight pain around the chest. okay, and both of them can cause aseptic meningitis. Okay, this is a picture of acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis. You can see that this is the conjunctiva, okay, and there are a lot of hemorrhages not just in the bulbar conjunctiva, also in the fundicial conjunctiva, right? So you have the bulbar conjunctiva here, it's all hemorrhaged, and here you have the conjunctiva in the fornix, there are hemorrhages here as well. So that's a case of acute hemorrhagic conjunctivitis, okay? Rhinovirus, again, rhinovirus, there are more than 100 serotypes of rhinovirus, okay? So that is the reason we do not have a vaccine against it. Kitna acha hota na, if we had a vaccine against rhinovirus, none of us would ever have suffered from common cold anymore. It's the commonest organism causing common cold. But sadly, we don't have a vaccine against it because there are more than 100 serotypes. So vaccine banana possible nahi hai, okay? Fine, next one. Poliovirus. I'm sure you've read all about polio in community medicine, right? So transmission is fecal-oral. It's also by respiratory droplets. But most of the infections are actually asymptomatic, okay? 95% of infections are actually asymptomatic, okay? And only 2% of infections actually progress to produce paralytic polio, okay? We are so accustomed to seeing people with polio having paralysis and atrophied muscles, but that happens in only 2% of infected people, okay? Now, you also have to remember that there is something known as chromatolysis, okay? Chromatolysis is seen in anterior horn cells. It is basically degeneration of the nissl bodies, and that is the earliest change. So they might ask you about the earliest change in poliovirus infection, and that is chromatolysis or degeneration of the nissl bodies, where in the anterior horn cells of the spinal cord. Okay, in the anterior horn cells of the spinal cord. Go to the next one. In HIV infection, the earliest antibody to appear is that against. Your options are GP120, GP41, P24, P55. Any answers? Okay, so the answer to this is GP41, glycoprotein 41. The sequence is actually glycoprotein 41. Antibody to this appears first, followed by antibody to P24 and P55, followed by antibody to glycoprotein 120. Okay, so 41 comes first. Okay, so you can remember that out of all the numbers, 41, right? So 40F say first, okay, and then it follows numeric load. Uske baad ascending order mein hai. So 41 comes first, then 24, 55, 120. Okay, so you have another question here. After that, we'll go on to discuss HIV. So a patient presents to a physician with complaints of passing frothy urine. Routine examination of urine reveals albumin is 412 milligram in 24 hours. A USG KUB reveals large echogenic kidneys. Physician orders for a renal biopsy. Renal biopsy reveals this picture. What virus is associated with this? So you have a question and an associated picture. The patient has complaints of passing frothy urine. So frothy urine obviously indicates proteinuria, hai na? Proteinuria hai patient ko. Uske saath saath kya hai? Proteinuria is supplemented by the fact that albumin, he is having macroalbuminuria, right? Macroalbuminuria, because it's more than 300 milligrams in 24 hours, right? So he's having macroalbuminuria. Along with that, it's supplemented with a biopsy picture. And here you can see all these pink areas, they are all sclerosed areas, right? Huh. And you can see that more than 50% of the glomerulus is affected with sclerosis. So this is, the pink areas definitely indicate glomerular sclerosis, and more than 50% or more than half the glomerulus is affected. So this is a picture of FSGS, focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. Okay, and this, you know, is classically associated with HIV infection in adults. Okay, HIV infection in adults. So your answer to this becomes HIV, right? Your answer to this becomes HIV. It's not BK polyoma, because we discussed that BK polyoma will present with interstitial nephritis, not glomerulosclerosis, and you're going to find decoy cell casts if you do a routine examination of the urine. CMV is also very, very common in recipients of kidney transplants, but again, it leads to nephritis. Adenovirus causes adenovirus types 40 and 11 and 21. They cause hemorrhagic cystitis, so they have nothing to do with the kidney. Okay, so you can automatically rule out adenovirus, it has nothing to do with the kidney. You can probably also rule out CMV and BK polyoma even if you don't know about the answer being HIV, because these two are again common in recipients of kidney transplants. Okay, so even by ruling out the options, you can arrive at a diagnosis of HIV. And if you can recognize the picture as FSGS, then well and good, because you can automatically come to the conclusion that yes, it is a case of HIV infection. Okay, and large echogenic kidneys, remember, in HIV, the kidneys are enlarged. Okay, so that is one of the DDs of enlarged kidneys. Fine. Moving on to the next question. We'll discuss a little bit about HIV. It's a retrovirus. The enzymes are reverse transcriptase, integrase, and protease. And you have drugs against both these genes. Structural genes, these are important. GAG encodes P17, which is present in the shell. Okay, it's present in the shell. So 17 is present in the shell. 24 is present in the core. Okay. Pol encodes the enzymes. So Pol for polymerase, it encodes the enzymes. ENV envelope, it encodes glycoprotein 160. This protease enzyme breaks down glycoprotein 160 into 120 and 41. Okay. So glycoprotein 160 is the original glycoprotein that is produced, and then using protease, it breaks down into 120 and 41. Remember, antibodies first appear against this, then against 24, then against P55, and then against 120. Okay? Okay. GP120, just to go over the genes really quickly. Glycoprotein 120, it attaches to CD4 on T helper cells and on macrophages. So 120 attaches, okay? And 41 is for fusion of the envelope with the host cell membrane by binding to the co-receptor. So GP120, it attaches to the receptor. 41, it attaches to the co-receptor. So 160 toot gaya, ban gaya 120 and 41. 120 attaches to the main receptor, 41 to the co-receptor. Out of these co-receptors, CXCR4 is lytic, which means it's going to lyse the host cell which has been infected to release the new virions. Okay, it's going to release the new virions so that these can go and infect more cells. And CCR5 is the transmitting co-receptor. Okay, so it helps in transmitting the infection from to other cells which have not been infected by the virus yet. So GAG, Pol, and ENV, these are structural. Okay, because they are contributing to the structure of the virus. ENV is the envelope, Pol is polymerase, and GAG. Okay. The non-structural genes, the important ones here are NEF. NEF, remember, it reduces MHC1 expression on virus-infected cells. Now, this is really important to remember. Cells which have high expression of MHC1, they are actually susceptible to destruction by the immune system. Okay? They are susceptible to destruction by the immune system. Cells that have a high expression of MHC1. Now, if the NEF from the virus reduces the expression of MHC1, then what happens? These cells cannot die because they are not attacked by immunity. Okay, so the virus proliferates happily. They are not attacked by immunity, so the virus proliferates happily inside the host body. Great. So NEF, therefore, it contributes to progression of the infection. It contributes to increasing the infection. Okay. VIF is also important because it inhibits ApoBeg3G, this is very important. So it causes hypermutation of the retroviral DNA, leading to increased infectivity. Okay, so both of these are responsible for high infectivity, NEF and VIF. Okay, the ones which are ending with F, okay, they are responsible for high infectivity. Okay, and VPR, it transports the viral core from the cytoplasm to the nucleus. It's important in latent infection. Okay. So the most important ones here are still NEF and VIF, which are important in the progression of the infection. VPR transports the viral core from the cytoplasm to the nucleus, so it's important in latent infection. It's not that important, but okay. Okay, moving on to the next one. Progression of disease is assessed by, it can be assessed in two ways. The most common is to do a CD4 count by flow cytometry. Okay, so you have to do a CD4 count and check whether the CD4 count of the patient is adequate or not, or whether it's dropping. Because the lesser the number of CD4 cells, it indicates more infection by HIV. It also indicates increased tendency of what? Of opportunistic infections. Okay. It also indicates increased tendency of opportunistic infections. Great. But the best way to do it is to actually assess the viral load by doing an RNA PCR. So the virus contains RNA. You do a PCR for that RNA and you estimate the viral load. So that will tell you exactly kitna virus hai inside the host's body. So that is the best way to do it, because you'll get an actual idea or an actual estimate of the virus, kitna virus hai, the quantity of virus. But the most common thing to do is not to do a PCR, it's to just do a CD4 count. Okay, so the most common and the best, these two are different. They might be important MCQs. Okay, coming to the next one. This is a question again. So we have this picture. Okay, just have a look at this picture first. Okay, so a neonate. Okay, presents with this picture. Which of the following is true regarding this condition? Bilateral cataract is the defining feature. Live viruses can be found inside the lens. Maximum damage occurs if infection occurs in the first trimester. The causative virus belongs to family Togaviridae. So, this is the picture once more. Okay. So, observe the picture and then these are your options. Bilateral cataract is the defining feature. Live viruses inside the lens. Maximum damage, infection in first trimester. Causative virus is a toga virus. What is the answer to this? Any idea? Any idea? What is the answer to this? Okay. Which of the following is... Okay, I'm sorry, there should be a not here. Okay, which of the following is not true? Okay, so the answer to this is bilateral cataract is the defining feature, because as you can see in this picture, the infant does have bilateral cataract. So you can see white in the pupillary area, which indicates that there is congenital cataract. So by this you can make a diagnosis of congenital rubella. Okay, congenital rubella infection. Now rubella live viruses can indeed be found inside the lens. This is true. Okay, and this is one of the reasons why there's a lot of inflammation associated with rubella infection and cataract. The viruses are live inside the lens, so there's a lot of inflammation. Maximum damage does occur if infection occurs in the first trimester. This is also true. Positive virus belongs to family Togaviridae. This is also true. Rubella is a toga virus. But bilateral cataract, remember, is not the defining feature. Okay. Congenital rubella has a triad. Okay. CHD. C for cataract. Okay. H for heart disease. Okay. The most common being patent ductus arteriosus, and D for deafness. Okay, and it is this sensory neural hearing loss, it is this one which is the defining feature. Okay, so out of the triad, if they ever ask you which is the most characteristic or the most defining feature of congenital rubella infection, it is not the bilateral cataract, it is the sensory neural hearing loss. Okay, so that's the false option, it's not the defining feature. I hope that's clear. So we'll move on to the next question. So we'll discuss arboviruses a little. Arbovirus meaning arthropod borne viruses. So all of them will have one or the other insect vectors. Okay, we'll only be discussing the important ones. Toga virus, chikungunya, Aedes aegypti. Okay, It also transmits dengue, Rift Valley fever, yellow fever. So you can remember this by the mnemonic CRYD. Okay? Cried. Chikungunya, Rift Valley, yellow fever, and dengue. All of these are transmitted by Aedes. Okay? So Aedes, cried. Okay? Rubella or third day measles or German measles. It does not have a vector. This is very, very, very important. So I just said arboviruses are arthropod born, so they will necessarily have an insect vector. But rubella is an arbovirus that does not have an insect vector. Okay, so it's an arbovirus without an insect vector. So that's an exception and therefore very important for MCQs. It presents with fever, rash, which is the typical blueberry muffin appearance. This is also seen in which other? We had discussed this last time. It's also seen in congenital CMV infection, right? The blueberry muffin appearance because of the petechiae rash. These petechiae that you can see on the pharynx, these are also known as Forshema spots. And they are not pathognomic, remember? They are not pathognomic of rubella, okay? Fine. Now this is a, you can see the pigmentation here. This is just a question that I decided to put in. You must be familiar with it by now. This is a typical chick sign, which is seen in case of chikungunya. Okay, hyperpigmentation on the nose. Move on to the next one. Okay. A family of three people are on holiday on a cruise ship near Brazil when all of them suffer from repeated episodes of diarrhea. So they are on a ship and they suffer from diarrhea. They get to know that many other people on the ship are also having similar complaints. What virus could be responsible for such an outbreak? Your options are rota, noro, adeno, and hepatitis A. Okay, now all of these, as you know, all of these can be associated with, first of all, all of them can have fecal transmission, right? Hepatitis A, definitely adenovirus 40, and 41, these cause diarrhea. Okay, rotavirus, you know, it causes diarrhea. Norovirus also. So what is the answer here? Out of all these options, remember the keywords here are ship and diarrhea. Okay, so whenever there's a question that mentions diarrhea in a group setting, okay, diarrhea in a group, okay, there's a group of people and diarrhea has affected all of them, the causative agent is likely to be the norovirus or the Norwalk virus. Okay, it's a calcivirus. Okay, it's likely to be the causative agent here. So, ship and diarrhea, these are important. That is pretty much the only thing that you need to know, because it might be a huge question and they might mention a lot of things, but the keyword will definitely be ship and diarrhea and the fact that it's a massive outbreak. Okay. So, why is it not rotavirus? We have ruled out rotavirus easily because rotavirus, remember, it is the most common cause of infantile diarrhea. Okay, 6 to 24 months infantile diarrhea, rotavirus, which is why Rotarix or Rotariq, okay, you have these two vaccines also, Rotarisk and Rotariq, okay, these are given to all children under 5 years, sare ko diya jata hai because it's the commonest cause of infantile diarrhea. Okay, it's also known as the double shield virus. Why? Because it has two capsids. Double shield because uska jo nuclear material hai uske around it has two capsids. Okay, so two capsids shielding the nuclear material, so it's also known as the double shield virus. Okay, so if you ever get a question that has a picture of a virus that has two capsids around the genetic material, it's likely to be the rotavirus. Okay, it has double stranded RNA. That's again an exception because we had discussed that all RNA viruses will have single stranded RNA except rhinoviruses, and rotavirus is a rhinovirus. The enterotoxin is non-structural protein 4. Okay, also the diarrhea does not contain blood and there is severe dehydration. So it's just watery, plain watery diarrhea, no blood, which leads to severe dehydration, and this can definitely even kill an infant. Okay, it's severe enough to kill an infant, which is why it's so important to vaccinate against rotavirus. Okay, fecal transmission, clean water and hygiene do not help in prevention. Although we had discussed this the last day, that रोटावायरस कैन बी डिस्ट्रॉयड बाय क्लोरिनेशन, ओके इट इज डिस्ट्रॉयड बाय क्लोरिनेशन, बट एट द सेम टाइम इट हैज बीन सीन दैट देर इज नो रोल ऑफ हाइजीन इन प्रिवेंटिंग रोटावायरस इन्फेक्शन, विच इज वाई वैक्सीनेशन अगेंस्ट इट बिकम सच एन इम्पॉर्टेंट मेजर. ओके next one, calcivirus, norovirus virus we discussed is the most common cause of viral gastroenteritis in adults. The source is shellfish, most common in people traveling in ships. So again, ships, diarrhea, if there's a history of eating shellfish, okay, then think of norovirus. Okay, fine. Now if the same thing is provided, diarrhea, history of eating shellfish, along with this agar jaundice hai, okay, this points to, and if there is no mention of an epidemic, then this points to hepatitis A infection. Okay, so agar ship mentioned hai, diarrhea hai, and there is history of eating shellfish, then that's norovirus virus. But if it's an individual who has diarrhea, jaundice and a history of eating shellfish, that's likely to be hepatitis A infection. Okay, fine, we move on to the next one. Okay, so these are Babes nodules. Which infection are they characteristically found in? Come on, this is an easy spotter. Which infection are they characteristically found in? It's been shown to you with arrows. Your options are diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus and rabies. Bol diya gaya hai that these are Babes nodules. Any answer to this? Okay, so the answer to this is rabies, and the purpose of putting this question is you must not confuse Babes nodules with Babes Ernst. Okay, Babes Ernst, remember this is a characteristic feature of Corynebacterium diphtheria. They are also known as volutin granules, right? They are also known as volutin granules, whereas Babes nodules, these are actually micro glial nodules, okay, and these are seen in rabies. Okay, so please do not confuse Babes with Babes Ernst. Okay, that's the whole purpose of putting this question, that you do not get confused between Babes and Babes Ernst. They are found, obviously, they are found in neural tissue because this is associated with rabies, and they are microglial nodules or lymphocytic aggregates. Next question, rabies. It's a bullet-shaped virus, right? It's a bullet-shaped virus, and it has these G protein spikes all over. Okay, they are known as G protein peplomeres, which are important for attachment, right? They're important for attachment. Antemortem dialysis and postmortem dialysis, the two are very different. Okay, antigen detection, antibody detection. Again, antigen detection, the best specimen for this is hair follicles, okay, of hair from the nape, okay, hair follicles of hair from the nape, and it's detected by immunofluorescence. This is a better sample than a corneal scraping. Okay, so you can either choose to take a hair follicle and then detect the antigen in that hair follicle from the nape, or you can choose to do a corneal scraping. Okay, you can also detect the antibody, whereas this is detected in either CSF. So you do a lumbar puncture, get some CSF, you can detect the antibody there, or in serum. Okay, so the specimen for detecting antigen and antibody, antemortem, is very, very different. Postmortem diagnosis, obviously, if the person is dead, there's no problem in taking a brain biopsy, so you take a brain biopsy and you will find Negri bodies in the cytoplasm, which is seen using which stain? Which stain is used to see Negri bodies? Does anyone remember which stain is used to see Negri bodies? It's the Sellers stain. Okay, Sellers stain is used to see Negri bodies. And which areas of the brain will I prefer to take a biopsy from? Either the hippocampus, to see the pyramidal neurons or the cerebellum to see the Purkinje cells. Okay, so dono areas P se shuru hote hain, either pyramidal neurons of hippocampus or Purkinje cells of the cerebellum. And remember, Negri bodies are produced by street rabies, not by fixed rabies. So street rabies is the wild virus which actually infects. Okay, it's not used in vaccination. This is not a component of vaccines. जो रेबीज वैक्सीन होता है उसमें यू विल नेवर यूज स्ट्रीट रेबीज, यू विल ऑलवेज यूज द फिक्स्ड वायरस व्हिच हैज बीन टोन डाउन बाय रिपीटेड कल्चर. एंड नेग्री बॉडीज आर प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय स्ट्रीट रेबीज. नेग्री बॉडीज यू कैन सी देम इन दिस पिक्चर. ओके, दे आर नॉट प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय फिक्स्ड रेबीज. फाइन, वी मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट वन. आई होप एवरीवन इज क्लियर विद रेबीज. या ओके, नेक्स्ट वन. द जीका वायरस इज एसोसिएटेड विद व्हिच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग. योर ऑप्शंस आर पीएमएलई, ALS, GBS and telogen formation. Okay. Any answers? PMLE, ALS, GBS and telogen formation. Zika virus. Okay, so the answer to this is actually GBS, right? It's GBS. Because PMLE, we had discussed, is associated with JC virus. Okay. ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, it is not associated with any virus at all. Pterygium formation, pterygium has been shown to have an association with the human papilloma virus. Okay. This is a relatively new finding. It has been shown to have an association with HPV. Guillain-Barré syndrome is associated with Zika virus. Okay. It's also associated with another bacteria. Remember, Campylobacter jejuni is also associated with GBS, right? So the two organisms which are associated with GBS, remember GBS ke saath kaun si kaun si associated hai? Ek hai Zika virus aur dusra hai Campylobacter jejuni. Theek hai? Fine. Okay, next one. Zika virus, again, it's a flavivirus which makes it an arbovirus. Okay, so it's transmitted by Aedes. It's also transmitted by Mansonia and Culex, but Aedes sabse zyada. Now, it produces the same symptoms, right? It produces fever with arthritis. So, there has to be something which will help you to differentiate a Zika virus infection from dengue, chikungunya, because these are also basically fever with arthritis. What is that? That is conjunctivitis. Okay. It produces conjunctivitis, which helps to differentiate it from dengue and chikungunya. Infection in pregnancy. This was a question in the last INICT. Okay. It vertical transmission produces microcephaly with neurocognitive defect. With what kind of calcifications? We had seen this in the last session. It produces subcortical calcifications. Okay. This produces subcortical calcifications. So if you see a CT scan, you will see that this is the cortical area, and you will see calcifications all around in the subcortical matter. Okay, you will see calcification in the subcortical area. This indicates that this is a case of Zika virus infection. Okay, fine. Next one. Okay, which virus is a typical shepherd's crook shape? Rabies, also mixed with Ebola, measles. Any idea? Any answers to this? Rabies, also mixed with Ebola, measles. Okay, so the answer to this is the Ebola virus, because I don't have a picture. But let's see. You've seen a picture of the Ebola virus. It has this typical, it's shaped like this. Okay, it's shaped like this. Okay, it's like kind of curly like a spiral thing. Okay, it looks like a worm. So that is your typical shepherd's crook shape. Okay, so just to go over filoviruses really quickly. Ebola virus, remember which strain has maximum fatality? Zaire strain has 90% fatality. Okay, there's a new drug for Ebola virus, very important. It might be a question. Okay, so is what is that drug? The drug is Inmarsat. It's a combination of three monoclonal antibodies MAFTIVIMAB, okay, Atovalimab, and Odesvimab. Okay, so it's a combination of these three monoclonal antibodies. Inmazeb, it's the first drug that has been approved by the FDA for Ebola virus. Okay, it has been approved just last year, so it's quite an important question because it's a new topic. Okay. Diagnosis, you can either detect antigen by capture ELISA, which is NPGP-BP40, or you can detect antibody against NPGP. Not that important, but if the question mentions NPGP or BP40, any of these, you have to think of an infection by a filovirus. Okay. Next one. Okay, hot topic, corona. I'm sure all of you know everything about it right now, but we still go over it one last time. It's a beta coronavirus, the one that's COVID-19. Remember, it's a beta coronavirus. Okay, it has single stranded RNA just like any RNA virus. It is positive sense. Okay, so negative sense viruses, just to go over them once more, it's arena, bunia, paramyxo, orthomyxo, phylo, and rhabdo. Okay, so even if you remember the mnemonic, you will know case mein C to kahin pe hai nahi. So that automatically makes coronavirus a positive sense virus. Okay, it has helical symmetry. Okay, and now a lot of cases of coronavirus have actually been associated with diarrhea, but whenever a virus which contains an envelope, okay, whenever the virus is exposed to bile salts, okay, what do bile salts do? Bile salts actually break down the envelope of a virus, which is why the virus dies, okay, and it is unable to cause, I'm so sorry, you probably can't see this, the virus is unable to cause diarrhea, okay, which is why we had seen that hepatitis A, remember, it doesn't have an envelope, which is why it can cause diarrhea, right? But an exception is the coronavirus. It does have an envelope. It can still cause diarrhea. Diarrhea is one of the associations that has been seen. So it's envelope, but it still causes diarrhea. Okay? Fine. Now, just to go over the genes, M, E, N, S, these are the important ones. M is a membrane glycoprotein, which forms the envelope, helps in budding. E is the envelope, N is the nucleocapsid, that is the capsid around the genetic material, which interferes with host immunity. S for spike protein, this is important. It binds to ACE2, angiotensin converting enzyme 2, which is present on type 2 pneumocytes. Okay, so it binds to ACE2 on type 2 pneumocytes, but it enters using another receptor, TMPRSS2. Okay, so everything 2, type 2 pneumocyte, ACE2 for binding, TMPRSS2 for entering. Okay, and the spike protein again has two parts. S1 binds to S2, S2 helps in fusion. Okay, RDRP, that is RNA dependent RNA polymerase. Okay, this is inhibited by remdesivir. So why is remdesivir actually used, or why is it useful in corona infection? Because it inhibits the RNA dependent RNA polymerase. Okay, so if it's going to inhibit the RNA dependent RNA polymerase, that's the RDRP. So the virus will not be able to replicate, and low viral load, so you're going to be able to manage the infection. Okay, the window period is 0 to 7 days. Remember, zero also, so it can have a really, really short window period, that is between infection and manifestation. And in that window period, an RT-PCR is best for detection. Okay, you have two tests, an RT-PCR test and a rapid antigen test. Okay, in dono mein se RT-PCR is better, because it can detect the virus even in the window period before clinical manifestations appear. Okay, IgG is positive on day 14. Isko alag se yaad rakhne ki zarurat nahi hai. In any infection, IgG does become positive by day 14 anyway, because first IgM appears and IgG appears after that, usually by 14 days. RT-PCR is positive if, now you have to remember these three things, because they might be given in an MCQ. Okay, wherever there is a triad or wherever there are three things, it becomes really important for an MCQ, because they might just add a fourth option and make an MCQ out of it, right? So RT-PCR is positive if nucleic acid amplification test is positive for at least two different targets on the SARS genome. Okay, सो दो टारगेट्स है जीनोम पे, उनके लिए नैट इज पॉजिटिव और वन नैट इज पॉजिटिव फॉर अ बीटा कोरोना वायरस. वी जस्ट सेड दैट कोविड-19 इज अ बीटा कोरोना वायरस और द वायरस हैज बीन आइडेंटिफाइड बाय सीक्वेंसिंग द जीनोम, राइट? सो ऑब्वियसली इफ यू सीक्वेंस द जीनोम देयर इज नथिंग बेटर देन एक्चुअली आइडेंटिफाइंग द वायरस दैट वे. सो यू हैव टू रिमेंबर दीज थ्री थिंग्स. ओके, कल्चर में यू नीड बायोसेफ्टी लेवल 3, आरटीपीसीआर बायोसेफ्टी लेवल 2. सो ऑब्वियसली आरटीपीसीआर इज जस्ट फॉर डायग्नोसिस and that can be done with a lower biosafety level than culture. In culture, you're actually trying to grow the virus, so you have more viral load, so you need more safety, so you need biosafety level 3. Okay, next one, the incubation period ranges from 1 to 14 days. So again, just like we said, window period is between 0 to 7 days, incubation period is again 1 to 14 days. So there can be a really, really, really short time between initial infection and manifestations, okay? But the median incubation period, that is the most common average incubation period in most of the population, has been seen to be 4 to 6 days. So remember, the answer to these two questions is different. Incubation period is 1 to 14 days, but median incubation period, or the most common or the average incubation period, is 4 to 6 days. Okay. Now, we in India have developed this indigenous test kit, Kavach ELISA, which uses IgG antibody. Please remember, it's IgG, not IgM. And you must have heard of Feluda by now, which is FN-Cas9 editor linked uniform detection assay, which uses CRISPR-Cas9 technology, so it gives results in less than half an hour. It's also not too expensive, so it's being considered as a great alternative to RT-PCR or as a test to detect COVID-19 infection. Okay, I also came across an article today that mentioned that they've come up with something that measures it measures lipid levels, okay? Lipid levels in sebum, okay? I don't know how popular it's going to become before NEET actually happens, but it is definitely being used right now. It measures lipid levels in sebum to detect COVID-19 infection, okay? So that's non-invasive and that's super if it actually works, okay? So it measures lipid levels in sebum to detect COVID-19 infection. Okay, so yeah, that's about it. Clinical features, we just go over this very rapidly. I'm sure you know this. Early, the virus binds to respiratory epithelium and gains entry. Again, binds, we discussed, is ACE2, and gaining entry is by TMPRSS2. It binds to type 2 pneumocytes. Okay, so if it's going to destroy type 2 pneumocytes, you know that type 2 are the ones that actually divide to replenish type 1 pneumocytes as well. So, agar wo mar gaye, so you're going to have ARDS, and if there's ARDS, there's going to be hypoxemia. But the problem is, peripheral chemoreceptors have also been infected with the virus. So, there is no hypoventilation despite low SpO2, which is known as happy hypoxemia. Very, very, very important. Okay. So, the patient might be having a really low SpO2, but if you ask the patient, aapko kya takleef ho rahi hai, they'll tell you, no, I'm fine, okay? Because despite that low SpO2, there's no hyperventilation. The chemoreceptors are not working, okay? So your phases are early, then pulmonary, then the last phase is severe hyperinflammation, which is actually a kind of multiple organ dysfunction syndrome, because there is a huge cytokine storm, okay? It proceeds to systemic inflammation. So it's not just there in the lungs, it has become systemic inflammation with a lot of IL-6, that's the marker, which is why drugs like tocilizumab, which is an anti-IL-6, that's actually very important in corona infection, okay? IL-6 is also one of the markers, okay? The more IL-6 you have, the more severe is the infection. Other markers include procalcitonin, your regular markers of inflammation like CRP, ESR, and ferritin, okay? These are all the markers, along with LDH as well. These are all the markers which are important in the case of COVID-19 infection, okay? Fine. Now, the two markers of severe disease are lymphopenia, so low lymphocyte count, and high D-dimer levels, because the more D-dimer levels, the more are the chances of clotting, and the more are the chances of embolus formation, okay? Now, something that I want to discuss with you is there is something known as presence of the APOL A1 gene. Okay, if this gene is present, APOL1 gene, that increases the chances of something known as collapsing nephropathy. Okay, APOL1 gene increases the chances of collapsing nephropathy. So that's that again is an important question for you. Presence of which gene increases the chances of collapsing nephropathy, or what is the lesion that is associated with the presence of APOL1 gene? Okay. Vaccines, again, there's still a lot of work going on in the field, but Pfizer and Moderna are mRNA based. In India, you have Covaxin, which is inactivated, okay, and Covishield, which is a non-replicating viral vector. Please remember, it's a viral vector, okay, so it's obviously non-replicating, okay. Okay, so that's about it. We've covered all the important points that I wanted to talk to you about. We come to the end now, okay, so I'm going to end this and that's all. So all the best for your exam. If you have any doubts, please feel free to ask, okay, and that's about it. Okay, so all the best to you.